morning, everybody. I'm so glad that you're with us on this final week of our series, Strapped, where we've been examining godly principles to put into use in our own life and our own finances. We promised you in our series in October that when we talked about vision, we're going to get practical, we're going to get real life, and I don't think it gets any more practical or real than when you talk about our pocketbook. Our theme verse for this series has been Proverbs 22:7. The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. We've talked about how the original word servant there is actually the Hebrew root for slave, that as we can become in slavery as we become in debt, and God wants us to live free, and we've been talking about how to live that life free. We've been talking about some practical steps on reorientating ourselves and then working some debt snowball. Those videos, you can contact us and we'll help you get the debt snowball, taking the little debt, rolling it in, piece by piece, taking a part of our debt, budgeting. Last week, Pastor Charity did a great message on budgeting and how that looks practically. And it's been great these last few weeks to hear some stories of, man, I wrote the list of everything I paid for this week, Aaron, and holy cow, do I waste a lot of money. And that was the idea when we write it down and then we start to budget and we make a food plan. We really see, hey, there are some areas where we can be better, because we really want you, you know, we do four things around here. We want you to know God, and we want you to find freedom, and we want you to be free to live a life on purpose, where you discover your purpose and you make a difference. We don't want you to live a life where we serve money, because as Christians, we don't serve money. Money serves us as we serve God. Money serves us as we serve God. And we give a little bit of sacrifice of the things we love now so we can pay off some debts, so we can love and live with those things down the road. We take a little bit of sacrifice for a life full of fulfillment. So to do that, we're going to start off today really, really simple and practical. We're going to watch a question and answer session between Craig Rochelle and Dave Ramsey. A lot of the principles we've been talking about have been based off of Dave Ramsey teachings. And I wanted to introduce who Dave is to you if you don't know who he is. Dave Ramsey was a man in the early 80s who had built a $4 million fortune in the real estate business. He was doing, in the world, very, very successful. And then due to some business transactions, due to some tax law changes, due to some mistakes he made, he went from $4 million to debt in a quick, short period, filing bankruptcy, was on near divorce, and here he is trying to raise a family with kids, and he's broke. But he started some principles in his own life, and he learned, and he developed some tools, and he started to put his life back together, and then in his church, he started to help other couples. And that has developed into the Financial Peace Institute that he has, that he has been on the radio for over 20 years teaching people how to get out of debt and live financially free. He had a television program for years on Fox. He sold dozens of books. But what his main goal is to take godly principles and put it in the church world, and so Christians can live free. And so he's really practical. He's really, really smart. And so I wanted to give you a chance to hear some on a variety of topics from Dave Ramsey before we continue this message.
Dave, thanks a ton for taking time to help us with Strapped. We love you at our church, and you've been a great friend and mentor to me. Let's dive right in. Dave, you recommend several baby steps that have been helpful to people all over the world. Can you give us the Reader's Digest version of what are the baby steps that you recommend financially?
Absolutely. Well, I'm honored to be with you. Thank you for including me in this. It wouldn't be right if we didn't do this.
That's right.
Just thank you.
Got to get
the
Dave in.
I'm honored. The baby steps are our way of applying God's principles that are in Scripture of handling money. Baby step one is $1,000 cash in the bank. It's the first thing you do, a little starter emergency fund. Two is the debt snowball. That's where you list your debts smallest to largest, pay minimum payments on everything but the little one, and attack the little one with a vengeance. Work your way right down through them. You'll get momentum emotionally that way, and hope will kick in, and it allows you to get through the debt. Then when you're finished with all your debt except your home, you move on to baby step three, which is 3 to 6 months of expenses, a fully funded grandma's rainy day fund. Then we do baby steps 4, 5, and 6 at the same time. 4 is 15% of your income going into retirement. 5 is if you have kids at home that you're saving for college, it's kids' college. And 6 is all the extra money then goes at the house. And we're seeing people pay off their homes doing the total money makeover of Financial Peace in about 7 years average, some longer, some shorter. That brings us to baby step 7, There's nothing left to do then but become very wealthy and give a bunch of it away.
And this stuff absolutely works, hands down, no doubt about it.
Absolutely.
Lisa asked, should I withdraw money from my 401k to pay off $9,200 worth of credit card debt?
Absolutely not. Under no circumstances would you do that. Now, my rule of thumb on withdrawing from the 401k is to avoid a bankruptcy or a foreclosure. I can't think of a case where there's a bankruptcy over $9,200. Not a chance. Because here's what happens. When you pull money out of the 401k, the government, the IRS, charges you a 10% penalty plus your tax rate. So if you're in a 30% tax bracket, that's a 40% hit. So, Lisa, that's kind of like asking me, hey, Dave, I want to borrow money at 40% interest to pay off my $9,200. Don't do that.
So Eric asked a question. He said, I'm 39 years old. I have three kids. I make $56,000 a year. He wanted to know how much life insurance should he get, and should he buy term life insurance or whole life insurance?
Okay. Second question first, never buy anything but term insurance. Never do investing inside of an insurance policy. You can see the lessons or my books for all the reasons, but always do your investing somewhere else. So 15 to 20 year level term insurance. Think about how old those kids, they'll be grown and gone in 15 years, okay, most of them. Maybe 20 years at the most. And you need about 10 times your income or 12 times your income on you. So let's say he's making $56,000 a year, he gets $600,000. He passes away, God forbid, we're all gonna pass away someday, but he passes away while the kids still need the money, the wife still needs the money, she could take $600,000, invest it. If she makes 10% or so on her money, she's making $60,000 without touching the nest egg. Well, we've replaced you. So don't buy too much insurance. You have to sleep with one eye open.
In previous weeks, I talked about the possibility of investing in maybe earning a 12% return. I used that in examples. And Terry said, he likes me and he's a Dave Ramsey fan, but he said 12% is impossible. Those days are gone. Mm. What do you think?
Well, I think that Terry is probably a young person who has lost his hope and lost his vision and doesn't believe America is going to be great. How does he know what the future holds? I don't know what the future holds. The only way I can judge investment returns are based on what they've done in the past. When I opened up a particular envelope in my home the other day and pulled out the prospectus of a mutual fund I own, opened in 1934, the average annual return since 1934 was 11.9%. That mutual fund last year made over 14%. So I'm not sure where Terry's getting his investment advice, but I'm not saying it's easy, and I'm not saying it'll always happen, because that mutual fund had some down years too when the market was down. But overall, an average of 12%, there's no way you can tell me absolutely with certainty it can't happen in the future. That's someone who's given up on the future.
Great answer, Dave. Adrian and her husband just got out of debt and they want to purchase their first home. How much money should they put down, and what's the length of the loan that you would recommend?
Well, of course, I like the 100% down plan. That's my favorite. But not everybody's going to be willing to wait that long, and it's not realistic maybe for some people. I don't borrow money, so I have to be consistent with my advice and not be hypocritical. It's the one area that I will tell you that it might be okay to do something I'm not doing. So we're okay with mortgages as long as you don't take out more than a 15-year fixed rate mortgage where the payment is no more than a fourth of your take-home pay. And how much to put down? As much as you can, because we want to turn around and pay it off as fast as possible. But again, always be debt-free and always have an emergency fund plus your down payment when you buy. Because if you buy a home with a bunch of debt, you know, you got Sally Mae, you got to buy an extra bedroom for her. You know, you got MasterCard around. He's telling you what to do when the water heater breaks. And you don't want all this stuff going on in your life. So you shouldn't buy a home when you're broke. It'll make you broker.
Well, Sam had a pretty serious question. He said he owes $22,000 on a car that's only worth $18,000. He's wanting to get out of debt. Do you have any advice for him?
Absolutely. You got two options, Sam. One is take four extra jobs and pay that thing down to what it's worth so you can sell it. Or the other thing is find someone, a bank, a credit union, it might even be the bank that loaned you the money on the car, to loan you the $4,000 that you're in the hole. And so I'd rather have you $4,000 in debt than $22,000 in debt. But you've got to be able to cover that four in order to sell it. Because if I'm the buyer, I bring you a check for 18, the bank's not going to give you a title until you put the other four with it. So you got to have that four figured out from somewhere. But I would figure that out and I would get out of that. That sounds like a trap to me.
Dave, I had a ton of people trying to cut expenses and they don't quite know how. They'll say there's really not any room. Based on your experience all these years of helping people, What are some common ways of cutting expenses that a lot of people may not necessarily see?
The biggest one's eating out. You know, you don't need to see the inside of a restaurant while you're getting out of debt unless you're working there. I mean, you just need to stay away from there. Eating at home is 80% cheaper than eating out. And it's just ridiculous. The more you cook from scratch versus pre-prepared in from the grocery store, you'll save that much more. Now, it's more labor intensive, obviously. It's also better for you. And so you get a better quality meal that way. That's a big, big one right there. And then the others are stuff like, you know, things we take for granted. We think vacations are like a necessity. They're not a necessity. You're not going on vacation. You're cleaning up your dad blame mess. And Christmas, I mean, I love Christmas. I mean, it's Jesus' birthday. I get that. But people have gone bananas at Christmas. And so, you know, Christmas, one year at our house, it was a craft. You know, I mean, we were trying to get out of our mess. It's not hard. So you know, it's different things with different people. But sometimes it's you can look at it. Here's what I have found. The more passionate you are about getting out of debt, the deeper you will sacrifice. Therefore, the faster you will get out. So there's a direct tie between the level of how fired up and wired up you are, game on, baby, and how quick we're going to get out. You'll find those things to cut, and you'll go to the other side and start adding income by working six jobs, man. I mean, you know, you work like a crazy person for a short period of time, work like no one else, so later you can work like no one else.
That's so good. Let's talk about the spiritual side of money. Darren from Sydney, Australia, he wanted to know, Dave, do you really think that God actually cares about what we do with our money?
Well, the way I look at it is, I'm really sure that my Heavenly Father is a father, and he's really crazy about me. Now, I've got three kids. I want good things for my three kids. And the Bible says this, if we being evil know how to give our children good gifts, how much more so our Father in heaven? Now, he's not concerned about money per se, but he is concerned about us and our welfare. And money is how that occurs. Money buys clothes for your kids. Money helps the poor. You know, you can go down there and feed them if you're poor, but you can go down there and feed them if you're rich, you know, and so money is a tool, and God uses that tool in his hands through his children to first provide for their families and later to change their family tree, then to impact their community and even leave a dent in the whole thing out there in the world. And so when we abandon money because we see it as filthy lucre, or we see money as a bad thing and it's not spiritual, then what happens is the other side is the only side that has any money. And they get their work done on the earth. And that's not our job. We're to take dominion over things. That's very clear in Scripture. But money itself, just to pile it up and roll in it, no, that's not what we're talking about. Money's fine. Get you some. But it's not the deal. The deal is what it does.
So good. Dave, there are so many people today that are hurting and deeply hurting. You're a strong Christian with a very committed faith in Christ. What encouragement would you have for those who are hurting financially today?
You know, when Sharon and I were broke and bankrupt and our marriage was hanging on by a thread, we were about to kill each other, I remember that. It's like every nerve ending is raw. You just feel like, don't touch me. You know, like you've been in a car wreck or something. It's awful. Now, all those years later, I look back and I see the trek we've been on. And the thing I remember is our life is not a snapshot. You're not stuck right there. Your life is a film strip. And so the next frame, something's going to change. And the next frame, something's going to change. And the next frame, something's going to change. Some of those changes are called God's blessings. Some of those changes are where you understand what you sow is what you reap. And so I figured out I had to quit sowing so much stupid because I was reaping desperate.
Favorite line right there. I was reaping a lot, or I was sowing a lot of stupid. I saw that line. I was like, yeah, that's me when I was younger. But now that's some good practical tips and advice we wanted to give you. Wanted to see Ramsey. And I'm not saying, hey, you buy into everything he's saying and you don't look and investigate. I'm encouraging you to look, investigate. He's the best one I've found, but that doesn't mean he's the best one for you. But I wanted to be practical. Now, I know a lot of people in the series have been like, okay, are we done yet? Can we get spiritual? Can we get spiritual? Can we just get deep into the word? We're going to do that today, okay? First, though, I need $100. Mike, you got a $100 bill on you? I need a $100 bill. You got a $100 bill? I need a $100 bill because I don't want to walk anywhere else. I want to just walk here.
In front of congregation, am I going to get this back?
I just need the $100 bill. Come on. We're in God's house. All right, cool. So Mike gave me a $100 bill. Thanks, dude. That's cool. So now, if you've missed any of these messages, go to gptacoma.info. They're on the hub because every week has built on the week before, and our videos are there. So you can get in there and see what you've missed while you were gone or wasn't able to be here. And then, no, don't go to the end of the notes. We have to start the message first. Thank you. So I wanted to start today by talking about tithing. I told you we're going to get deep. We're going to talk about tithing. We're going to look in the Bible. And the first thing I know is if you've been here, hold on, we'll go back, Mike. I've talked about, we're not going to talk about giving in this whole series. I've made that promise to you, right? Like every time we've got up and said, don't worry, we're not going to talk about giving in this series. And now I told you we're going to talk about tithing, and you're like, he lied to me. That guy lied to me. Come on, Pastor, you promised you wouldn't talk about giving. And you're right, I'm not going to talk about giving. I'm going to talk about tithing. And we're going to start with the examining tithing and giving and showing they're not the same thing. We interject them as the same word a lot of the times. I tithe when it's giving. So we're going to take a systematic approach, dive deep into tithing. I'm going to do it as gently as I can. We're going to get through it. We're going to grit our teeth. No, I'm just kidding. We're going to look at Scripture and see what it has to say. In your notes, in a worship guide, there is all our fill in the blanks. There is all the Scriptures we're going to use. If you don't have one, raise your hand, and if we've got a couple left, Stephanie will give them to you. Here's what I want. I know when you talk about tithing, everybody gets... Grin and bear it, grin and get us. Come on, let's get through. Here's what I'm asking today. I'm asking for this morning to come on a journey with me for the next 25 minutes. I'm asking you to open your heart, open your ears, open your mind to what God is saying to you. I'm asking you to fill along in the notes. I'm asking you to take the Scriptures and examine them as we read them. Then I'm asking during this week, you take it to God and go, did that guy lie to me on Sunday, God? Or is this what you're trying to say to me? God, what is this saying to me? What am I supposed to do with this? So that's what I'm asking. You listen, I'll talk, and then you take it to God this week in your prayer. Can we make that deal? Everyone says yes. Yes. All right, so let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you for this moment this morning, God, as we're going to begin to talk about tithing and the right perspective on money, God. So we pray first for our eyes, our ears, and our heart to be open to what you say and your words say, God, this morning. This is not what Aaron has to say, God, but let my words be your words. Let your Scripture stand on its own. And God, that you move in this room. And finally, God, we end with this prayer. God, we pray for healing in Husky Land as we lost on Friday night. Some of us are struggling with this. But God, we know you can persevere and get us through this. You are our strength in times of trouble. In Jesus' name, amen. Somebody says, I only brag in the good times. I'll talk about my prayer in the tough times. So this morning, we're going to talk about the difference between giving and tithing. So I said, some people use them as the same thing. Well, I went and I tithed to this group. I went and I tithed to the TV guy. My favorite is, I have a family member who is not a part of this church. You won't know them. Who I went to the Christian bookstore and I tithed to the Christian bookstore my income because I bought some books. The problem is that's not the technical definition of tithing. That's called giving. And all of those things are good. Giving is good to do, but that is above and beyond the tithe. So let's start with, okay, what is tithing? What's the word tithe mean? In Scripture, the word tithe means 10%. That's literally what the word is, 10%. It's a Hebrew name or Hebrew word mean ma'aser, ma'aser. You got to get a little rumble in your throat. I don't always do it so well. Ma'aser. That is what the tithe is. Tithe is ma'aser, 10% of my income. So when I tithe, in your notes, tithing is returning the first 10% of our income to God's church. So we're going to examine the 10%, the first, and income to God's church. We're going to examine those this morning. So we're going to start in Leviticus chapter 27, verse 30. It says, a tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, the first of everything, a tithe belongs to the Lord. It's holy to the Lord. And the word holy means set apart. It means separated. It means this is set for God and everything else is left over. So what tithing is, it's not giving, it's technically returning. It's something where we give back to what is not ours, it's what is God's. Now, you can't give what's not yours. Like this morning, Mike gave me $100. But what you don't know, I gave Mike the $100 before service and said at some point, Mike, I'm going to ask for my $100 back. Now the perspective changes, right? No longer am I a bad guy that took Mike's money. I gave Mike, whose money is this? It's mine. I gave it to Mike. I said, I'm going to ask for it back, and Mike gave it back. And unfortunately for Mike, I'm not God, so he returned it to me, and I get to keep all of it. Now, here's what God does. God says, hey, Mike, here's $100. You can have $100.
Thank you.
Can I have 10 back? I need 10. I gave you a 10. I need 10.
I gave you 100.
But that was my 100. Now I gave you 100. You can keep the 90, and I just want 10 back. That's yours. But who's more generous? I gave him 90. He gave me 10. Who's more generous, me or him? So if God says, I'll give you 90, and I only want 10% back, who's generous, us or him? It's him, right? So what we do is we say, you're so generous. Of course, the deal is you'll give me $90 or $100 and all I got to do is give you 10. We'd sign up for that deal from any bank any day of the week. Because here's what happens in your bank world. Oh, 10%, that's so much. You go buy something on a credit card. The credit card says, okay, we want the 100% of your money back and we want 18% on top. You've paid an 118% deficit. And God's like, I will make you 90%. You won't lose. You'll make 90%. So we have to look at it first that way. We're giving back what isn't ours. We're only returning a small portion. And God's saying, I'm so generous, I'll give you the 90%. Now, he didn't get that deal on the first. I took 100 back. So that's how we have to look at it. We bring 10% to the house of the Lord, which is the storehouse. Then we go on to the next point, which is tithing is giving God my first and best so he can bless the rest. We give God our first so he can, and our best so he can bless the rest. So the next scripture we're going to look at is Proverbs chapter 3. It says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits, not second fruits, not the leftovers. The scripture says first fruits. All of your crops, and then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. So we take our wealth, we honor God with it by giving our first fruits, then our barns will be overwhelmed. So we're going to talk more about the blessings of tithe in a minute. We're going to stick first on this question of tithing, what is it? And what else is the Bible saying about tithing? It says, bring it to the storehouse. Give God the best. Give God our first. Why do we do that? Well, one of the reasons we do that is because tithing provides for God's work through his church. Your next point in the bulletin there. Tithing provides for God's work through the church. So this is, now we're getting into the why do we do it. First it's the what, now the why. When you tithe, it provides resources for God's work to be done through the local church. Now you say, well, why the church? Because God loved the church. The church is God's plan. Jesus loved the church so much, he came and died for the church. We are the bride of Christ, his church. God loved the church. Jesus loved the church. So we should love the church. So let's go dive in a little bit deeper into this idea we give so the church work can be done. The next scripture in Malachi 3:10 says, "Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house." Bring the whole tithe, bring it to my storehouse so there may be food in my house. Theologians will tell you, and it is widely accepted, this word storehouse in the Old Testament, because they didn't have churches like we do in the New Testament, that the storehouse of the Old Testament is the picture, is the point to of the New Testament church. So you just take out storehouse and you put church in there, and theologians across the board agree that's what the scripture is pointing to. We bring the whole tithe to the church that there may be food in the house. That the work that the church needs to be done, there is resources to do it. I've made a joke a lot in the last few weeks about we don't sell hamburgers here during the week. Everything we get, it all comes through the tithing. You know, we don't have a burger pop-up stand to help supplement the bills. We did have an estate sale for 2 days, and that helped. But we exist because those who at this church and over the family of Grace Place's existence have given to the church. We're all beneficiaries of who's giving and who gave long, long ago and paid for these chairs and the carpet, paid for the heat to be on now, paid for everything. We are benefits of those people. Now, as we have grown as a church, what we have found ourselves in is a position as a church is everything that's coming in is having to go out just to maintain the facilities and maintain the status quo. And we've done the best we can. This church is not in debt other than the building. We haven't had to borrow money to pay bills, borrow money to do this. Everything's been covered, and except, you know, $1.2 million, whatever it is, mortgage. That's the only debt this church has had in 9 years. But what we recognize is if we're going to be this church, I keep using that name, the church, what does that mean? Well, it's a family. It's a people together. We've said we're not a building, we're a community. But are we just gathering together and hanging out and having a party for one another? No, we are a body that comes together to be equipped, ministered to, reach lost people to go into our community and make a difference. But as a body, if all the money's going to just support a building, we don't have any money left to do the work of God, which is feed the hungry, help the homeless, take care of the widows, take care of the people in here, take care of the needs of our community. And so we've made the decision, hey, we want to show the church an example of how we honor God with our finances and not just exist, but we want to thrive and be a thriving member of our community. So as we take a step back in a facility and we reduce our debt load, that's going to free up resources so we can start doing the things the churches are supposed to do. We have become a society that relies on the government to fix all our problems. It was never meant to be that way. The church is supposed to be the hub, and everything else comes around it. Everything else comes out of it. Everything else is affected. Government, families, education, entertainment, sports, all of that the church is to have their hands in, helping all of those people know God, find freedom, discover purpose, and help them make a difference in the world. So we're going to take a step back as a church, honor your giving, but that doesn't mean like, well, our bills are less, I can give less. No, we want to give even more so we have even more money to go out into our community and be the church. And we're committing as pastors that we are not going to run on 100% any longer. The goal is all the money comes in, we give 10% of it away. Your church is giving away giving because we believe in tithing. You are helping a church plant in Bellevue every month right now. A young couple who planted a church, we are feeding into them. You are helping plant churches around this country through our partners. Your Bibles across the world. Water systems across the world. Your giving in this last year has brought the ministry and have brought preaching and churches into prisons across this country through God Behind Bars. We've helped feed people through the Dream Center in LA. Even a little bit, we're still making a difference, and we're just going to continue to raise up how much we do as we go forward. So 10% gives away, 10% goes to savings so we can save up money to take care of our next facility. And then we're going to, the expenses of the church now has gone really big. We're basically going to take my salary out of it. We're going to take care of the house. We're going to take care of the bills, to have a place to meet, to have warmth in it, to see, to hear, all that fun stuff. And then everything else, we're going to go do something in this world. We're going to do something in this community. And it's all done because you bring the tithe to the storehouse. There can be food in my house. So what's tithing do for me? Well, the first thing tithing does for me is it teaches me to put God first. It teaches me to put God first. Deuteronomy 14:23 in the Living Bible translation says, the purpose of the tithe is to teach you to always put God first in your lives. He put it there so it reminds us all the time, put God first. Seek him first. It's natural for us to have a desire, like Charity and I have tried to build this discipline, and I'll be honest, it's tough sometimes, but I want to seek God before I do anything in the morning. I am working really hard. I don't touch my phone and go to Facebook or Twitter until I've had a few minutes of prayer or a few minutes of worship or just talking to God. I want to start my day, and we talked this week about we can notice a difference in our week if we've started our day off with God or not. I'm a lot more peaceful in stressful situations if I started out with God. Those days that we don't make it a priority, we are at each other's throat. We are stressed out. We are pulling. Well, I don't have hair. We are, you know, when we don't do that. The first of the year, Charity and I have a tradition, and we're going to encourage the church to join us this year. The first 21 days, we pray every morning for an hour, and we fast for 21 days. I want to give them the first of my year. Why do we meet on Sunday? Because in our calendar, Sunday starts the week. So we give them the first part of our week because we want to put God first in everything we do. Putting God first requires faith. Because if you give it to him last and it's left over, there's no faith in that. Oh, I guess I have something left. Here you go. Instead of, I don't know how this is going to work, but okay, here you go. First requires faith. Now, I hear you saying, like, wait a minute. So I've gone through this. You want me to reduce my spending. You want to fix budgets. You want me to do a debt snowball. Now you want me to give money. Do you understand, Aaron, what that's going to mean? Yeah. It means you're going to have to get radical about this. Like, Aaron, I'm going to have to stop doing some things I do in my life so I can put God first. Yep. I'm going to have to orient my life out of things and events and towards God. Yep, I get it. I know it. That's the point. We want to get radical and put God first in everything. Because if I told you God wants the first of your time, yeah. He wants the first of your heart, yeah. He wants the first of your thoughts, yeah. He wants the first of your money, whoa. Now, see, all means all. He wants to be full first in all areas of your life. Because when we're not putting God first, the scripture is really clear, and I'm not going to say anything else. I'm going to let the Bible talk for itself. Malachi chapter 3, verse 8. God's talking to the people, and he says, well, will a man rob God? Yet you rob me. And the people say, well, God, how do we rob you? He says, in the tithe and the offerings, you are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. He says, what was mine, you took and spent it on something else. So what I know right now, I've read a lot of scriptures in the Old Testament, and I have many people in this room who are thinking, amen, but that's Old Testament, sir. That's Old Testament. That's under the law. And you've taught us we are no longer under the law. We are under grace, sir. So therefore, tithing under the law does not apply to me. Okay, so let's go through the calendar. Genesis was not under the law. See, there were Genesis events. God creates the earth, Adam and Eve, their kids. Then there was Noah, and then along comes this guy, Abraham. And the Bible talks about how Abraham tithed his income. And then his sons come along. And then we go a little bit longer. You have Joseph in prison. Then you have the 400 years of in captivity. Then here comes Moses. And then they go wander in the desert. And way over here is the law. Way back there, tithing started. And then it's reconfirmed in the law. Tithing's a principle that comes before the law. It supersedes it by 400 to 500 years. It predates the law, which comes So if I got you there, now you're going, but Jesus didn't talk about it. I was told Jesus never mentions the tithe, Aaron, so it's really not something we should talk about. Jesus was really great. Every time he taught in the New Testament, it's assumed that he just kind of like, oh, everything's so good. Everything's so nice. You know, the law, bad. Oh. But if you look at the stories, he went and took the law and then he raised the law. The woman who was caught in adultery, right? Or no, I'm sorry. He talks to a crowd. And he says, you've heard the law says you shall not commit adultery. And they're like, yeah, you shouldn't sleep with somebody else's wife. He goes, I say you can't even look at somebody with lustful eyes. He went from an action to a thought. The thought's way easier to do than that. I mean, he raises the bar, right? He says, in another instance, you shouldn't murder someone. The law says don't murder. Jesus goes, I said you shouldn't even hate anybody. That one is a struggle, I think, for all of us because we live in this world. So when he's challenged, he always ups the ante. So let's look at Matthew chapter 23:23. He says, what sorrow awaits you teachers of religious laws and you Pharisees? I love Jesus because he only fights with one group of people. All through scripture. The know-it-all, super religious, look at us, look how good we are, Pharisees and high priests. That's who he fights. He hands dinner and hangs out with the prostitutes. He hangs out with tax collectors, all the scum of society. Those were the guys he fed life into. The only people he ever fought with was high and mighty people. And here he's giving them a tongue lashing. You hypocrites, for you are careful to tithe even the tiniest income from your herb gardens. But you ignore the more important aspects of the law, justice, mercy, and faith. You should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things. He raises the bar again. Yeah, you should tithe. That's basic. But you should do all this other stuff too. Hey, don't just forget the tithe, but then the rest of your life should line up as well. Your actions should matter. Your actions should be changed. Jesus, in that set of scripture, in this version, he says tithe. I think in your King James, he says the titheth. Come on, some people, that was funny. He says the tithe. Yes, you should tithe. He clearly talks about it and he raises the bar, says that's basic. Then what's the rest of your life look like? So that's what he says. So then tithing also builds my faith in God. It builds my faith in God. So we've got tithing teaches me to put God first. Tithing teaches me to build my faith in God. Malachi chapter 3, right in the middle of verse 10, it says, God looks at the people and says, now test me in this and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room for it. The earlier verse was, you're robbing from me, you're not giving my tithe. And now he says, now do it and try me, bro. I double dog dare you to tithe. I double dog dare you to test me. It's the only place in scripture where he says, test me. It's the only time. If you do it, watch me. Watch what I can do. You don't think I can? I'm going to kick open the floodgates of heaven. I'm going to pour it down on top of you. And it's going to go running out the windows of your house. And you're going to withstand it. Don't try me. And that's what he's saying. He's, try me. We often ask for more faith. And if you're guilty of this, you may know this lesson already. Faith is not something God goes, bam. You went from a level 6 to a level 8. He makes you learn it. There's usually a trial that comes along. There's usually a struggle that comes along that puts your reliance, because nothing else is going to work. So God, you better work, because I ain't got no hope without you, because it's going to, if I take a step, Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark. Is that the last? No, the third one. The Holy Grail. You ever seen that? There's the big cliff. And it says, take a step of faith. And Indiana's like, there's nothing there. So he closes his eyes and says, okay, I'm going to take a step of faith. And he takes a step, and he lands, and his foot catches something, and then the bridge is revealed to him. That's how faith is built. Faith isn't to go, oh, look, there's a bridge. Okay, God, I take faith that I'll step on it. No, faith says, I don't see where to go. I don't see how to get there, but I'll take it. So God will ask you to take a step without the answer, or the vision or the direction sometimes just to see, do you trust me? And that's how we build faith. This is coming from a guy who has gone through a year-long process of come on, God, just take me to level 9. Let's take me to level 9. He's like, no, we're going to walk to level 9. So we have to walk through faith sometimes. Now, when we say, God, test me and you'll pour out your blessing, so I'm testing you. Give me my slot machine, all cherries, double sevens, Wonka Vaders or whatever. This is a slot machine that gets us in danger of thinking it's money for money. He says it's blessings. And we get very wrapped up in, and you hear a lot of teaching. You give, you get, you give, you get. You're going to double, press down, shaking together. You put in a $10, he'll give you $1,000. But, it's not always money. He might say, well, thanks, your tithe. I'm going to honor your tithe. I'm going to bless your marriage. Man, I wanted money. How much would a better marriage be worth to you? Your tithe is going to be cheaper than counseling. Your tithe is going to be cheaper than a lawyer. So our tithe, it might just bless our marriage. We tithe, you might just be happier. You might just start walking around. Why are you happy? I don't know. I just got the joy. Joy, joy, joy. Not down in your heart. Where? Down in your heart. No. Like joy that's outside where people don't have to ask where it is. Your kids might see you tithe and go, wow, this God thing might be real. I might just have to look into it. I might just have to say, maybe I want a relationship with Jesus. See, it's more than money. Sometimes it is money. I'm not discounting that. That is part of the blessing. I come from a long line of tithers. My grandparents, great-grandparents, my parents did. And we were broke. My dad tells this great story. Oh, there was come a moment when there was no money to pay the bills and to feed the house. We were done. All he had left in the budget was the tithe money, and he had to make a choice. Do I feed the family, or do I trust God and I tithe? I'm giving the very abbreviated version. And he tithed. That morning, he dropped it off to the church, went to work. God, I don't know, God, what you're going to do. I don't know how this is going to work out, but I'm going to put you first. And they got home that afternoon, and there was groceries on the front porch. And to this day, 30 years later or 35 years later, we don't know where those groceries came from. But I've heard that story, and that story spoke to me. Not that my parents, who have made, a very low income, who tithed every day, who shouldn't have retirement, now have a retirement, and they're living better retired than they ever did in a day working. And they're giving away more money than they ever have. And my dad says, I can't give it away. It just keeps coming. I don't understand. But I watched my parents give, and it spoke to me about their faith, and it made it real to me. So when I struggled with my faith, I had an example to follow, and I kept tithing, and it spoke to me because God blessed me. I went to a school I shouldn't have gone into. I went with debt free a few years later. I now stand here because long ago I had people in my life who honored God with their first, who my dad told me the other day, I don't care about any of the money, but I know that I honored God so my kid could stand on a stage and reach a community of people. That my other two kids are raising up godly kids. And if we all died tomorrow, we were all going to heaven. So if it was nothing more than I honored God and he took care of the rest, then it was all worth it. And that's what we're looking for. Give God my first and my best, and then let him take care of the rest. 90% blessed is a whole lot better than 100% unblessed. It takes faith to give first, so I will give God my first. This church will give God its first, so he can bless the rest. So 4 weeks we've talked about finances, because we don't want to learn the definition of the Greek word for life raft. I want to give you a life raft. Because we're all drowning in areas in our life. So this series, don't let it pass. Don't let this moment of inspiration pass. Take the tools we've given you this last few weeks. Go buy a book. Go listen to his radio podcast with his team of brilliant people. Find a guy. Find your guy. And break free from the bondage and slavery so we can live life like no one else. The more we get is a responsibility to give more of it away, to make a difference. Money provides opportunities. Money provides times, and it provides options so we can make the biggest difference as individuals and as a church. Let's pray.